Hello, my name is David Faure and I work for KDAB. In this video, I would like to show you how to implement a DBus client using Qt. And for now, we are going to use asynchronous APIs to do that. The first step is to generate code that we can use from the client to talk to the server. And in fact, there are two steps there. We have implemented a server. Now, what we want to do is to generate an API description from that implementation. And in DBus, API descriptions are done with XML. So we want to generate XML from the header file here that implements our DBus server. And Qt provides a tool to do that. It's called QtDBus CPP to XML because we are converting from C++ to XML. And we give it, so we say all of the scriptable slots. That's exactly where our API is. We give it the name of the header to read, and the output file is going to be an XML file, which is usually named after the interface, so you recognize the interface name in it. Now, if we do that, and we have a look at the generated file, you'll see that it has get flag name, but it doesn't have get matches, and we don't really know why. It skipped one of the methods. Now, that is something I fixed in Qt 6. So if we do the same with the Qt 6 version of QtDBus CPP to XML, it's actually in 6.3, then this time we get a warning that says, wait, the type QList of person is not actually registered to DBus, so it doesn't know how to translate that. So that is much better. We know that there is a custom type in there, and we need to tell it how to handle it. And that is another thing I implemented in Qt 6.3, which is the support for custom types with the dash T option, where you can say, if you see QList of person, then it should be encoded as, and now it gets a bit specific, this is a DBus type. In DBus, S is for string, the curly braces mean basically a struct, and the A means an array. So this is an array of structs, and each struct has four strings, which is basically, that's exactly what person is. If we have a look at the person class, it is a struct with four strings. And we are returning a list of persons, so this is an array of person structs. So that is the only little bit of DBus-specific type that we have to pass. Everything else is standard, so it knows how to translate that to DBus XML. So this time, if we run the tool with these arguments and we have a look at the generated XML, then we see that it has our getMatches method, and it does say that the output parameter, which is basically the return type, is our array of four strings. But when this is going to be used the other way around, how to generate C++ from this XML, it will have the opposite problem of how to name the resulting type. So actually, CPP to XML tool adds an annotation that says the Qt type for this is QList of person. And this way we can sort of reconstruct the proper type name on the client side. This is a Qt-specific annotation, but everything else is a generic standard DBus. When we say, for instance, we take a string in, that's the country name, and we return a string out, that's the name of the flag, this will be understood by any standard DBus implementation. All right, we have our XML file. Now, what we want to do is to generate a header, or actually, it's called basically a proxy class. The proxy class is what we are going to use on the client side to talk to the server. And the whole benefit of doing that is that it's type safe. We can't pass a parameter of the wrong type because it's going to be checked at compile time. And it's also typo safe because if we call a method that doesn't exist, it will just not compile. So how do we do that? That's the opposite tool. It's the QtDBus XML to CPP, right? We convert XML to C++, but we don't have to call that one by hand. We can just let CMake do that for us because in that step of the translation, this works with any version of QtDBus XML to CPP. So we can just automate that and make it part of the build. And we do that here with the CMake function called QtAddDBusInterface, which will run the conversion tool for us and generate the proxy class. Let's have a look at that proxy class, see what it looks like. It will look like this. It is a DBus interface, the client class for making DBus calls, and it has generated our three methods, getFlagName, getMatches, and quit. And what we see here is that those methods do not just return the value that we want, because that would be synchronous and blocking, and we don't want that in the main thread. So instead of that, it returns something called a pending reply. This encapsulates, in this case, a QString, and we can use that and keep it at hand to be notified of when the result is available, or if this is not the main GUI thread, then we can block for the result to be available. So what does that look like in our client code? The first thing we have to do, obviously, is connect to the server. That's actually what we do here by creating an instance of that proxy class. That's when the client connects to the server, and we give it the name of the server, that's com.kdab.peopleserver. We give it the path to the object, and again, this has to match what we did in the server, /peopleserver. So these two things are actually in a shared library so that the code is shared. And then which bus? Well, the only bus that we are interested in is what's called the session bus. That's where your processes will talk to each other. The only other bus is the system bus, and that's for kernel or system level things, which we are not interested in. So we are connected to the server here, but to be able to do that, we need to make sure that the server is running. So just like in the case of local sockets, we have to handle all of these cases of the server being brought up after the client, or the server going away unexpectedly. And this is nicely done by the class QtDBus Service Watcher. We tell it, I am watching for this server name on the bus, and I want to be notified whenever it appears, it disappears, or it moves to another process, right? We could have a new process coming up, a new server, and it claims the same name, and if it's allowed, it will take over that name. So the service continues to be available, just implemented by a different process. Okay, so when the server is up, we connect to it. And if the server goes away, we can actually disconnect nicely from that server and wait for it to be brought up again. And now, how do we actually make the calls? Whenever we want to do, let's start with querying for matches. When we call that generated getMatches method in the proxy class, what we get as a result is a pending reply, which will contain a vector of persons. Because we don't want to block, right? This is the GUI thread. What we'll do instead is create a watcher, and the watcher will emit a signal when the when that reply is actually available. So we connect to the signal here, the finished signal, and in the lambda that is implemented here, we can then call value, and that's where we get the actual result, right? The vector of persons, and from there we can treat it as usual, as we did before. Simply iterate through it, remember the name of the countries, put that into a list of pending country names, and query for these. This is the same asynchronous code as we saw in the video about local sockets. And then one after the other, we are going to query for those countries, and that's done by this method here, where we take the first one, call getFlagName, and it's the same mechanism again. We get a pending reply, we connect to its finished signal, and we handle that in a lambda that is called later on. And don't forget to actually delete the watcher objects, because every time we make a call, we create one. And yes, we pass this as parent, but this only means that they will all get destroyed when we quit the client application. But if it keeps running for a month, then we will have accumulated all of those watcher objects for nothing. So you have to remember to delete them. And because we do that in a slot connected to one of their signals, we can only use delete later rather than a direct delete. Otherwise, it would crash. All right, I think that's all I wanted to show you. To summarize, we have, you know, starting from the implementation of the server, especially the header file, we generated XML, which is basically the same thing, but in the standard XML representation used by DBus. This would allow us to have other types of clients connecting to it with other implementations, for instance. And we have then used that XML to generate a proxy class on the client side to make it really easy to write client code. We don't have to implement the low-level bits of the protocol. We just call a method, connect to a signal, and wait for the response. Just as before, what we did here works, and it doesn't block the GUI, but it is a little bit cumbersome to have to deal with a list of pending requests to be made, and everything is asynchronous. So in the next video, I will show you how to do this with blocking calls by moving all of that into a secondary thread. If you have any questions about this video, don't hesitate to leave a comment on YouTube, and I'll take a look. Thanks for watching.